Welcome back to the Eat, Drink, Explore Radio Network. Here now is your fabulous host, Mr. Randall White.
And a good morning to you. So glad you can join us here each and every Sunday morning, 9:33 the time, as we discuss all things food, beverages, and travel each and every week from 8 to 10 right here on this very station. And this portion of Eat, Drink, Explore Radio brought to you by the Harvest Festival Original Art and Craft Show at the San Jose Convention Center, November 29th through December 1st. So that's next weekend, Thanksgiving weekend, including Black Friday and Small Business Saturday. So it's perfect, really. Get your shopping done for those special people in your life and, you know, get things that are made by local artisans and really unique. You won't be at the, you know, at Christmas, everyone's opening their gifts and, you know, there's a lot of the same gifts being opened. Yours will be unique and locally made. Also, a reminder, we are giving away several sets of tickets, including at least one family four-pack to this Harvest Festival. Great place to get those gifts, as I mentioned. Now, really easy to enter. Just friend us on Facebook or Twitter and mention us then in a post saying you want to go. Username, Eat Drink Explore for both Twitter and Facebook, all one word. Or you can email me personally, Randall, R-A-N-D-O-L, at eatdrinkexplore.com. Or you can give us a call right now. We will answer the phones for the next 5 minutes or so, 805-439-3505. Again, 805 area code 439-3505, giving away tickets to the San Jose Harvest Festival. Now, to our guest segment. You know how passionate we are at Eat, Drink, Explore Media when it comes to fresh and local produce and gaining access to these foods for school children. Well, a program by the USDA is handing out hundreds of thousands of dollars here in California to support several schools that have innovative farm-to-school programs in place. And joining us on the Eat, Drink, Explore live line right now to explain how that works exactly is Kevin Concannon. He's the undersecretary for the USDA's Food, Nutrition, and Consumer Services. Great to have you on the program, Kevin.
I'm thrilled to be here, Randall.
When I read this news release earlier in the week, earlier this past week, I just thought, well, that's fantastic. I didn't even know the USDA encouraged these sorts of things.
Well, you know, we have for the past 4 years now. In particular, we've been encouraging what we call broadly farm to school, which really has as its basic elements promoting more school gardens, mm-hmm. promoting more local purchasing, and really putting an emphasis on educating students in the school to where food comes from, and in the process, encouraging those students to eat healthier. You know, in California each day, 3 million students alone participate in the National School Lunch Program. Right. And, of course, California is, if not the most diverse agricultural economy in the country, and you can grow around year-round out there, and yet even in states like California with all that abundance, you'd be surprised how many students really think food is coming from the supermarket chain instead of connecting it back to somebody has to grow it. And with this farm-to-school initiative, again, now in its fourth year, has really been developing even more and more momentum each year as a way of both connecting students to local foods, especially fruits and vegetables, which is the part of the American diet that people of all ages do least well at. That is, most of us don't consume enough fruits and vegetables. We'd be better off health-wise if we did. And to the extent that schools help connect kids back to that, we have our motivation underlying all of that is twofold. It's one, to get those kids to eat those locally grown foods. I've been down in, I recall being in the Riverside School District last year, and this year I was in the Oakland School District. Both cases, the schools had pretty significant school gardens, and they were cycling various classes out over the course of the year to work on the gardens as a way of really educating them. And when I was at that Riverside school, these were second or third graders came out. they told me more about the benefits and the health benefits of strawberries than, you know, some of the PhDs we have hanging around the ag department here.
Isn't that great?
They were very impressive. They really were. And they were very proud of the fact that they, you know, were tending those plants.
Yeah.
So it's very exciting for us. And as you mentioned, a number of school districts in California were successful in getting these grants. And we see the grants as more catalysts, really, to further the effort, because other schools hear about this from their peers who are in the either teachers or in the school nutrition side, and it prompts them to say, well, we could do that in our school as well. We could have raised bed gardens, or we could have, you know, a half acre set aside that is not so much for industrial purposes to feed the school as much as it is to connect kids back. The school I was at in Oakland a couple of months ago, they were so thrilled there that they were talking to me about vermiculture, how they are...
Is that the worms?
Worms. Mm-hmm. And all the things they were doing with worms. And the kids brought me over to this compost bin, where again they had, you know, millions, I suppose, of worms, but they were talking about worm castings and how they place them back in the soil and the difference that it makes. Well, to me, that was music to my ears, because one, they were connecting kids. This is in Oakland, you know, an urban part of the country and part of the state.
One of the schools that is a recipient of this money.
Yes, that's right. I'm not sure if it's that same school I was at, but there is a school in Oakland in the Unified District that has won a grant as well.
Yeah, Oakland, the Unified School District there got, for implementation of a new plan, I imagine, $100,000. It ties with the Pittsburgh Unified School District for the most amount received for another implementation program for $100,000. I'll just quickly go down the list here. Modesto City Schools, implementation grant for more than $90,000. And, you know, speaking of Modesto, they're there in the Central Valley, which is really the hotbed of agriculture in the state. And we just had a gentleman on the program last hour who has started up this mobile farmers market to get fresh produce to some of the rural areas in Merced County. And I was talking to him about the irony of the fact that people that live in this really agriculture-rich region are not eating the fresh produce that's grown directly around them.
Yeah, no, that's it is an irony, and we run into that, you know, in places like Florida and California and up in Michigan, where they have a very diverse, you know, farming economy as well. That it's strange. People are, as I said earlier, we get too disconnected from where food comes from.
Yeah, Pasadena Unified School District gets a planning grant for more than $44,000. And then finally, the Sweetwater Union High School District in Chula Vista, down in the southern portion of the state, also nearly $45,000, also for planning. How did the department go about choosing which schools would receive these grants?
Well, we had about 350 or so applicants this round, and this is the second year that we've done this. And they look for schools, one that were a combination of some were planning and to help them get really launched. Others were in a little further along, let's say, in developing their infrastructure. For example, some schools, depending on the geographic areas in the country, were putting up hoop houses, which are ways of extending the growing season in colder climates. So they look for both. So the leadership factors, you know, who's really promoting this in the school, and then what's the likelihood that they're going to be able to carry it out successfully, and then they try to spread them around the country, so to speak.
We hear about cuts left and right when it comes to programs like this. I'm glad to see that this one has survived.
Yep, this is part of the authorization for this program came from the Healthy Hunger Free Kids Act of 2010, which was bipartisan passed, one of the last, unfortunately, major pieces of domestic legislation, but it's very focused on school meals, on programs like this, farm to school, on nutrition education, helping people to better understand what they need to do to keep themselves healthy by healthy eating, and also focused on summer eating, the time of year in the U.S., unfortunately, when an American child is much more likely to go hungry, principally because school is out, and in low-income households, that can be a real challenge for those kids.
There's no greater incentive to get these plans going than the financial version, which you're doing by issuing these grants. We've had some celebrity name power here in the state in Southern California. Jamie Oliver, pushing for this sort of, you know, these sorts of projects. In the northern half of the state, Alice Waters in the Bay Area, famous for her Chez Panisse restaurant in Berkeley. I know that she has a lot of plans like this going on as well. But to see it coming in at the federal level, I just found that to be significant. And that's why we wanted to have you on the show to talk a little bit more about it. Any plans to expand
that.
It?
I appreciate that. You know, we're 56% of the schools in California now have some version of our farm-to-school program. We just did a survey of 60,000 schools selected across the country, and we had a very high response rate. Almost 80% responded to it. And California is well ahead of the curve, no surprise. Mm-hmm. But 56% have a program, another 14% have indicated they're planning to start. And they spend right now about 18% of school food budgets in the state go out into local purchases. So, and no surprise that some of those local top products purchased in California, citrus, apples, lettuce.
Strawberries, probably.
Berries, carrots.
Kevin, I got to stop you there. Kevin Concannon, Undersecretary for the USDA's Food, Nutrition, and Consumer Services. Thank you so much for joining us. Best of luck with the program.
Well, thank you, Randall. Great to be here.
All right, everyone, stick around. You're listening.